Hello, my name is Sandeep, and like Mike said, I work here at the MIT Media Lab in the object-based media group, and I'm going to be talking about some of my work in direct fringe writing of diffraction-specific coherent panoramagrams in the photorefractive polymer for the updatable holographic display application. So Brittany has already introduced the Nitto-Denko photorefractive polymer material. It has properties of fast write time, long persistence time, rapid erasure, and large area. And this combination makes it especially attractive for the application in the updatable three-dimensional display. So just to recap on their imaging system, they use put Hoagl information on the SLM to modulate an object beam, which then interferes with the reference beam and the Fourier transform geometry inside the material. So because it does involve the interference of a signal beam and a reference beam, the system is limited in its compactness and its extensibility. And furthermore, you require a long coherence length in the writing beam. And furthermore, the conventional stereogram technique removes the full wavefront curvature of the ideal wavefronts. And so this introduces some visual inconsistencies to a system like this. Specifically, you lose accommodation cues. Just sidestepping a little bit, I'm going to talk about some of Hiroshi Yoshikawa's work at Nihon University. So they've developed for the past 5 or 6 years a direct fringe printer, which images parts of a large computer-generated hologram in an area-by-area approach onto a static recording material. Again, the material is static, so it's not dynamic. But they've achieved feature sizes in the image of 0.44 microns at the moment. So brings me back to the current study. The work here is really to develop an alternative optical and display architecture based around this idea of direct optical fringe writing for any general computer-generated holographic fringe pattern for exposing this Nitto-Denko material. And the scheme is actually pretty simple. We take data from some 3D model or maybe from a range-finding camera or whatever, generate a computer-generated hologram algorithmically, display the hologram on an SLM, demagnifying it using some demagnifying optics, expose a photorefractive polymer with a single beam. So the motivation for doing this, again, reintroduce accommodation cues to the resulting holographic image via adaptation of some of the algorithms that we've developed here at the Media Lab to drive our holographic video displays. And more generally, we can increase affordances in the type of hologram that can be recorded. And finally, we want to simplify the optical geometry of the recording and the display systems, and thereby reduce footprint, complexity, and cost in the display system. Challenges for doing this, of course, if you want to get a good viewing angle in your resulting holographic image, you need a feature size of about a micron or less. Again, if you're demagnifying the image from an SLM, the image that comes onto the photorefractive polymer is going to be pretty small, so you need to do some sort of a spatial multiplexing or raster scanning technique in order to generate a large image. And furthermore, you want to compute your fringes such that they can reconstruct a 3D scene faithfully with correct visual cues. Now, this is sort of a new area of research, so this photorefractive polymer hasn't really been studied under the conditions of direct fringe writing, so we're sort of venturing into new territory here. Goals and scope, really the end goal of a project like this is to meet or exceed the performance metrics of an interference-based system using this more simplified and more flexible direct fringe writing system. But the scope of the current study is really to test the feasibility and the viability of this direct fringe writing approach in comparison to the interference-based stereogram approach. Questions that we're posing are, one, can we achieve a high diffraction efficiency? Two, can we achieve a view cone that's suitable for a direct viewing of the hologram? And can we achieve fast write times and persistent images with this technique? So we're limiting ourselves to horizontal parallax only at the moment, and we're wanting to achieve a look-around angle of about 30 degrees with a diffraction efficiency that is suitable for direct viewing. So for fringe computation, we're going to be adapting an algorithm that we've developed here at the Media Lab for our holographic video systems called the diffraction-specific coherent panoramagram. Again, of course, this is a diffraction-specific approach to real-time holographic stereogram generation. It does provide correct visual accommodation cues when smooth motion parallax, and you actually need far fewer views than you do with a normal stereogram to generate that parallax. So on the right-hand side, you see the holographic element, which is just comprised of a sequence of plane waves with varying intensities. In our diffraction-specific coherent panoramagram approach, these are actually comprised of wavefront elements, or waffles. And so we're able to emit arbitrary wavefront curvature at all different directions with arbitrary intensity. And so this reintroduces, this gives us wavefront control rather than trying to approximate an ideal wavefront via the superposition of plane waves. So it turns out that the DSCP does converge to a Fresnel hologram in the limit of a large number of views that are taken to compute it. On the bottom right, it's very hard to see on this display, but on the left-hand side, we did an experiment superimpose two letters. Left-hand side is the holographic stereogram algorithm, and letters N and a D, and it's very hard for the camera to disambiguate the two. But on the right-hand side, and you'll trust me on this, the camera can actually focus on the N instead of the D. So to do the computation of this, we're actually exploiting the Z buffer or the depth information from a synthetic or a real scene. We use that information to select some appropriate chirp gratings. Next, those gratings are then modulated with the information of the luminance in the scene, and then we assemble those all together to create the correct holographic line. Again, this requires far fewer views than a normal stereogram to produce a smooth motion parallax. And again, this has been originally developed to drive our holovideo system, that video rates, all in GPU. But for the current implementation, I'm just going to be doing all of the computation offline, take those fringes and put them into as input to this printer. The spatial light modulation, there's a company here based in Kendall Square called Silicon Microdisplay that's fabricating these LCOS modules for head-mounted display applications. So they have an 8.5 micron pixel pitch, fill factor 88%, 1080p resolution. So we're using this in an amplitude modulation configuration with two cross polarizers to retrieve the amplitude modulation. The optical setup for the system is pretty simple at the moment. We have a diode pump solid state laser at 532 nanometers continuous wave. That's then expanded and then collimated through a set of beam expanding optics, reflected off the SLM, again in that cross polarizer configuration for amplitude modulation that I mentioned. The optical system to image the SLM into the photorefractive polymer is telecentric, using cylindrical optics now because we only care about demagnification in the horizontal direction, not in the vertical. So the nominal demagnification is, of course, given by the ratio of the two focal lengths of the lenses. In this case, I'm using an input lens with a focal length of 250 millimeters and output lens of a focal length of 50 millimeters, so the demagnification is 5 times. Given the pixel size of the SLM, this results in a nominal pixel size at the photorefractive material of 1.7 microns. Given the maximum output power of the laser, we're actually limited to a maximum irradiance at the PR material of 2.5 watts per square centimeter. For illumination, I'm just going to be using a helium neon laser that's expanded through an optical spatial filter. Right now, the Heaney has a power of 30 milliwatts. So the setup, all lit up. So on the left-hand side here, you see the laser, the beam expanding optics, the SLM with the cross polarizer is the first lens of the telecentric system. The aperture stop, and behind the aperture stop, you can't really see it, is the second lens of the telecentric system. And kind of bathed in red there is the photorefractive polymer. The illumination setup is on the right-hand side, the laser and the spatial filter. So I mentioned before that we have to use some sort of an optical spatial multiplexing technique to generate a large image. So this just gives you an idea of what this looks like when it's printing. This video is sped up for reasons of time, but the fringe pattern that we generate is very long horizontally, so it's split up into pieces that can fit within the resolution of the SLM. And then each of those are imaged serially into the material, just like this. So for automation and control, we have a PC, and it's controlling the DPSS laser, the shutter control, and the power. The LCOS module is sending the data to that translation stage for the raster scanning, and the DC power supply that's providing the bias voltage for the photorefractive material. And all of this is implemented using LabVIEW 2011. So some results. We first did a validation test with diffraction gratings, imaging diffraction gratings directly from the SLM onto this photorefractive material. Diffraction gratings at the SLM have a half pitch of 8.5 microns, and through this telecentric system, we observe a half pitch of 2.5 microns. This was back calculated from the observed diffraction angle and the illumination angle. Observed diffraction efficiency of about 8% and an estimated grading persistence of maybe 5 minutes. Okay. So you know, this kind of gave us the idea that we can actually do this. So, again, very hard to see here, but this was my first print using not the DSCP, but an earlier HPO stereogram algorithm. the model is of this teacup, and this is the print here. Actually, it suffers from, it's kind of hard to see. Let me just bring up the blinking again. So the blinking sort of indicates where it is in the material, and you'll have to trust me that it is actually there, but it does suffer from low diffraction efficiency, low discriminability, a limited view cone, and kind of short image persistence here. But we do use an exposure time per elemental of 10 seconds. Total writing time is maybe 300 seconds, and total image persistence is 300 seconds. Oh, I should clarify that the image persistence is the image persistence for a single elemental. So the problem is that we're writing from right to left here, so the rightmost fringes have actually started to disappear at the time this photograph was taken. So furthermore, we're actually use the DSCP algorithm to generate the fringes from the Stanford bunny here. And the picture is a little bit better, so you can kind of make out the shape of it. But again, we suffer from the problems of low diffraction efficiency, low discriminability, a limited view cone, and a short image persistence. So a few of the problems here. The problem of persistence, really, I think the sample that we're using actually doesn't exhibit the persistence that has been reported earlier by the Arizona team. So it might just be a matter of swapping in a new sample to fix some of those problems. The low diffraction efficiency may also be a function of the image contrast that we're actually getting at with the telecentric imaging system. And of course, the fringe visibility does directly influence the diffraction efficiency. So using a refined optical system with a better MTF might be able to help us there. For the limited view cone, of course, the telecentric system at the moment is only imaging, demagnifying by a ratio of 5. So we have to design a better telescope to image smaller feature sizes. And low discriminability, that may also be a function of the illumination source that we're using at the moment. So a stronger beam and a cleaner spatial filter may help. Some future work. So we've previously demonstrated the creation of diffraction-specific coherent panoramograms from real scenes using a single Kinect camera. It's range finding, so it has depth and luminance information, converted to 3D scenes, convert to 3D space, generate parallax views, which are shown here in the bottom left, and then generate a fringe pattern. This is actually an earlier example. We sent the parallax views over to Arizona's display, and they actually printed it using the holographic stereogram method. But this is easily extendable to this direct fringe writing approach. So in summary, we think that this direct fringe writing approach has the potential to simplify system architectures, allow for greater affordances over the hologram control. And we've developed and we've built up a test bed for testing some of these direct fringe writing experiments with this photorefractive polymer. But you know, the results right now do indicate that we have poor diffraction efficiency, poor image persistency, limited view cones, and limited discriminability. So there is a lot more work to be done. Okay, I would like to thank the Photonic Science and Technology Group, Nasser Pygmalion's lab at the University of Arizona for initial work in this area, Nido Dinko Technical for providing some of the samples that we use, Silicon Microdisplay for providing the SLMs that we use in our work, and finally the Digital Life Things That Think and Consumer Electronics Lab Consortia, and the Center for Feature Storytelling here at the MIT Media Lab for the funding. Okay, that's it.
Slides and the light is still green. So if anybody would like to ask Sunny any questions, go to the microphone.
Thank you, Sandy. I have a question. My question is it possible to further develop the DSCP algorithm to generate full parallax? Because your holographic system is suitable for display the full parallax.
Exactly. So right now we're using chirped 1D gratings to compute the DSCP. We can actually move to 2D Fresnel zone plates and modulate those with the scene luminance information. It's a pretty straightforward extension. We just haven't done it yet because we don't have a test bed for full parallax images.
I probably need to talk to you about this afterwards, but I'll just mention that I've done a lot of work with bacterial rhodopsin, and I see some advantage with bacterial rhodopsin that I'm not seeing with your system. It might be something for you to consider.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, thank you again.